everyone. I'll be discussing my honors thesis, Riding the Korean Wave, an analysis of Korean drama streaming. Korean dramas have been popular for many years in Asian countries and have fans all around the world. Their popularity is fueling opportunities for online video streaming sites that air subtitled versions of their dramas outside of South Korea. The main purpose of our research is to gain an insight about how TV content is accessed and consumed through these online streaming sites. Through this research, I want to begin to understand the consumer's perspectives towards Korean drama streaming sites and provide information gathered about these sites for content viewers as well as the streaming sites themselves. To start, I'd like to touch on a few topics from my literature review. The Korean Wave, also known as Hallyu, is the phenomenon of Korean entertainment and pop culture increasing in popularity across the globe. The pop culture products include pop music, also known as K-pop, TV dramas, and movies. In the past, Asian countries such as Japan and China have had access to Korean dramas broadcast on their local television networks. A majority of foreign countries have access to the Korean drama TV content through online streaming, and that's how a majority of European countries access this content, as well as North and South American viewers. The online technology has impacted the reach of the Korean Wave. YouTube also plays a crucial role in marketing and distributing K-pop internationally. Unlike TV or radio stations, entertainment agencies can use YouTube to directly promote and advertise their content to large international audiences in various countries. Social media and online communities also provide an area for fans to connect with people with similar interests. Next, I will start looking at components of my market analysis of the Korean drama streaming industry. These are all key players in this industry. They are video on demand streaming services, and all of these sites offer some level of Korean TV content to viewers. Next, I will look at business models for these various services. The first model is a free or advertising video on demand approach, which uses an advertising based revenue model. This allows companies that usually advertise to broadcasting or cable channels to reach out to viewers who are using these video on demand sites. The model also allows viewers to watch content without paying for subscriptions. The next model is a subscription business model, and it's a revenue model where the customer must pay a fee to access the service. These usually are monthly or yearly subscriptions. Examples of the video providers that use a subscription model are Hulu, Netflix, and Amazon Prime. They offer various subscriptions at price levels for different customer needs, and their prices vary from $8 to about $12 a month, and Amazon has a yearly subscription for $99. The last model that I looked at was called a freemium model, and this provides one tier of content for free viewers. It includes advertisements, but it restricts the rest of the access to premium features, such as access to new content and no advertisements to paying subscribers. Examples of companies that use this model are Viki, Drama Fever, Crunchyroll, and On Demand Korea. The premium packages available for these sites start around $4 a month and can range to $9 a month. The next component of the market analysis is regulatory issues. I first looked at piracy and legal problems that face the Korean drama streaming industry. A lot of free sites still offer Korean content illegally, meaning they don't have the appropriate licensing from Korean broadcasters. And this isn't just a problem for Korean dramas, it's also a problem for other cultural content as well. For example, one of the sites that people said they used to view Korean dramas was recently involved in a lawsuit against a large Philippine TV network because they were streaming their content illegally without licensing. And another requirement for regulatory restrictions is getting licensing from the Korean content providers. Drama Fever, which was created in 2009, was the first streaming site to have licensing agreements with all three of the big Korean broadcasting network stations, KBS, SBS, and NBC. Also, each streaming site that has these licenses has to create their own agreements with the companies, meaning each streaming site has access to different shows, and a lot of them don't have the same providers for each for their content. For my thesis, I did a descriptive study on creator owned streaming, analyzing the development of these global content streaming sites and consumers' perceptions of their services. The study also helps identify legal streaming alternatives to unlicensed free TV content for drama viewers. The market analysis portion of the Korean drama streaming was used to further understand the role of online streaming in the Korean wave. And I also ran a study to a survey to provide details on Korean drama viewers' perspectives. The survey was distributed online through the K-drama Reddit in order to obtain a more diverse sample for the study. The participants had to agree to a consent form, and none of the participants received compensation for their responses. The survey included multiple response, multiple choice, Likert scale statements, a few open response questions to help obtain as much information as possible from the sample. Here's some demographic information from the responses I received. I received a total of 175 responses for the survey. And next, we can look at some of the findings from the multiple choice and Likert scale statements from the survey. The first table on the left looks at streaming sites each respondent uses to view watch Korean content, and they can choose as many as they used. So the most popular ones were Drama Fever and Viki. I think this is because they have the most content available out of Korean TV content. Another thing I found interesting from this information is some people listed that they used illegal sites to watch Korean content. They just wrote it in the open-ended response. And also 30 responses used Kiss Asian, which was the site that had legal issues with the Philippine TV network. The other chart on this page documents which respondents said that they paid for any one of these subscriptions, and about almost 60% said they did pay for a subscription. This next question was an open-ended response to see how much people would be willing to pay per month for a subscription. Anyone could answer this one even if they didn't have a subscription at the current time. It ranged from $0 to a maximum of $50 per month, and the mean of the data was $8.59, which is some of the subscriptions that I mentioned earlier are below this price, so people would be more willing to pay for subscriptions. And these ones, the information on the left is for people that said that they paid for a subscription. So the top motivations for them paying for these were no advertisements. They wanted to watch content without interruptions. The second response, frequency response, was the HD quality content. And then the third was access to premium content. On the right, the information is for people that did not have a subscription, and we asked what would motivate them to purchase one. Again, the number one response was no advertisements. And the second was early access to content, and third was premium access. These are all the Likert statements that I used in my survey. These were rated on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being strongly disagree with the statement, and 5 being strongly agree. The table on the left shows questions regarding all Korean drama streaming sites. So we took the mean of the responses to see what the average opinion was regarding the statement. So on average, the responders said that they, from using the sites, their interest in Korean dramas increased, and their interest in other Korean cultural products increased. And they strongly agreed that using these sites made access to Korean dramas easier. Regarding Seobol Murray, was regarding their favorite streaming sites, and they said their favorite sites had the best user interface, offered the best content available, and had content available quicker than other websites. Some insights I received from the open-ended responses were some ideas regarding subscriptions. Someone mentioned worldwide licensing, which is a good idea, but I don't think it's possible. Even big TV content providers like Netflix can't offer worldwide licensing for all their content for each country, they have different license agreements with the broadcast agencies. Another suggestion was to have subscriptions for the number of hours instead of a monthly or yearly subscription. So this would work better for people who don't have time to watch a lot of episodes during a month, and they can just use it over a set for those number of hours. Also, another suggestion was to pay for access only to Korean dramas, because a lot of these sites have access to other content from other countries like Japan and Taiwan and the Philippines. Another suggestion from Open Response was to slightly change the free advertising business model and just add a big chunk of advertisements at the beginning so there's less interrupted time during streaming. And I thought it was interesting that respondents said that they used piracy sites and unlicensed streaming sites, and even people that said they paid for subscriptions also used these sites to access content that wasn't available on the sites they paid for subscriptions. Okay, there were some limitations, limited response from international viewers, subjective and no feedback from the survey respondents that said they wanted a do not know option for the scale question. Thank you for your time. Are there any questions?
No, are there any questions for everyone at the end? So, thanks, Jessica.